The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
See Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is brought to you by RF Bank and Trust and Royal Star Assurance.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. I trust and hope that all is well with you. If you want to give us a call today, the numbers to do so are as follows. You can call us on 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Or you can call us on 325-4316, 325-4316. Or you can call us on 325-4259. That's 325-4259. Or you can text us on 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. We are live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show. Or you can catch us on BTC Flow channel 612. That's BTC Flow channel 612. So, what's happening in the Bahamas? I have to ask. Because there are some weird things that I see. They're weird to me because they just seem to, in some ways, beg for answers, if not defy some logic. So we're going to talk about some of those things today, right? The first of which is the National Insurance Board. National Insurance Board. So, okay, the government of the Bahamas is responsible for the National Insurance Board. In the government of the Bahamas, national insurance has now for several years, including when I was in the Ministry of Finance, it was with the Ministry of Finance / Prime Minister's Office as a responsibility policy directorate responsibility, right? The Prime Minister is the substantive minister responsible for the National Insurance Board. But the designated over policy oversight of the National Insurance Board falls with the Honorable Miles LaRoda, who is the Minister of State in the Ministry of in the Prime Minister's office. I can say this until the cows come home, but there are some people who will not get it. So I'm not talking to those people. I'm talking to people who want to learn, understand. Miles LaRoda, as Minister of State, is not a junior minister. You can say it 10,000 million times if you want. That's not true. A minister of state is not a junior minister. Let me say it three times. A minister of state is not a junior minister. Let me say it again. A minister of state is not a junior minister. What's a junior minister in a government? A parliamentary secretary is a junior minister. A parliamentary secretary is a junior minister. A minister of state is merely a minister without portfolio, meaning when the ministers go to get sworn in, the minister with portfolio gets a document from the governor general that says, these are the areas of government that fall under your responsibility. So you're the minister with portfolio. The Minister of State can float in any ministry at all. He or she is simply a minister. They then get designated responsibilities within a portfolio. So while the prime minister has many responsibilities, he can have any number of them have nothing to do with Miles LaRota, because Miles LaRota is the Minister of State and has within the portfolio of the prime minister a certain set of things for which he has charge. Okay, and then a parliamentary secretary may have an even narrower set of things and may even come under the responsibility of a minister of state. So if the minister of state is a junior minister, then the parliamentary secretary is what? A junior minister? Because a parliamentary secretary is a minister, but is a junior minister, right? Even though we don't have these designations per se in our constitution or what have you, but this is your form of government, you want to do this. It happens all over the world, right? Now, here is what I find challenging, though. Miles LaRota, the Minister of State with responsibility for National Insurance Board, seems to be making a urgent plea that the contribution rate of national insurance has to, as a matter of urgency, go up. He is making a plea that the chairman of the National Insurance Board is making, that it has to go up. They are making the plea that a report of the National Insurance Board situation has indicated for years has to happen. It has to go up. His most recent plea says the National Insurance Board is going to lose $95 million this year because the rate hasn't gone up. He's saying all these people who are talking about, oh, just go collect your outstanding monies. He says that is nonsense. Why? Because even if we collected the outstanding money might amount to $30 million, but we're going to lose $95 million. Where is the $65 million going to come from? He's making that plea. Now, in truth, National Insurance isn't losing $95 million. I don't think that's the best way to put it. National Insurance has obligations to pay its contributors benefits in accordance with their contributions. So it is in a situation now, as Miles LaRota points out, the minister, where people are living longer, people are claiming benefits, there are more benefits to be had than revenues being taken in because the rate is too insufficient. And he's saying that on the basis of that, the net difference for the National Insurance Board between what it takes in and what it pays out in benefits, this is not like a business loser. Well, okay, yeah, it's a business losing money because it's an expense, but it's really you're paying no benefits, right? He's saying that that amounts to $95 million. So he's saying there's a plea. Here's where it gets interesting for me. Miles LaRota is a member of the government, the executive branch of government. Not only is he a member of the executive branch of government, he is also in the portfolio of the prime minister, who is the chief minister of the executive branch of government. And he is saying, we have to do this. I was a little confused because I heard him saying, you know, these armchair people sitting around talking this and talking that, et cetera. But the armchair people commenting ignorantly is one thing, but the armchair people can't make the rate go up. Even if they argue and rouse stupidly, they're not the ones who can make the rate go up. The rate going up is a matter of the cabinet of the Bahamas making that decision. That's how it happens. The prime minister has to make it happen. But the prime minister is the minister's portfolio minister, and they are in the same ministry. They are in the same cabinet. But yet the prime minister when asked about this matter, said, I'm trying to find the Prime Minister's words because I don't want to misquote the Prime Minister. Let me see if I could hurry find it for you. I mean, the essence of what the Prime Minister said is that, you know, is that he is not doing this because he don't want to put that burden on the Bahamian people, right? So this is what the Prime Minister said. He said, I would wish not to speak to it because, as is my mandate, I continue to say that I am going to try to resist. I am going to try to resist putting more burden on our poor and working class. Yes, we have looked at the matter. We understand that we have to do something. And we are trying to identify exactly what to do. Increasing the rate is one of the options that we are looking into. Okay, so the minister is calling for a rate increase. The board is calling for a rate increase. The professional report is calling for a rate increase. But the Prime Minister says they are looking at options at what to do. And the rate increase is one of them. Besides the fact that the Prime Minister and his minister are not on the same page, and that's not unusual, that's not impossible. Ministers differ. I know some of you all don't think so, but ministers can differ with their prime ministers. I know I have. I know I have. I ain't asking none of y'all. I used to listen to people say to me, oh, you just singing for your supper and y'all will never stand up to the Prime Minister and blah, 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 and so forth and so forth. And I listened to all of that and I said, I laughed. Some days I was very angry about it, but I said, okay, you know, that's what they believe. But it happens. Ministers and their prime ministers differ. What I find interesting, though, is how this is playing out in the public sphere this week. This is not usual. Y'all could think this bravado all you want. You could think this is New Day all you want. This is not normal. This is not normal stuff. That does not happen, right? That you have the Prime Minister and the Minister of Public Works again at odds publicly. That is not normal. And if anyone who thinks it's normal, you go back to Sir Lyndon's cabinet and see how often it happened. Go to Ingram and see how often it happened. Go to Christie's and see. It is not usual. It is not normal. You want a unified government. That's why you have the cabinet confidentiality so you can hash matters out, cuss who you want, cuss, say what you want, say, and come out and be unified. Right? So there is it's not normal. And the thing about it is, Mr. LaRota's plea, which when I read the Nassau Guardian's account of the comments he made, his venting seems to have been targeted toward people who are not making sense about what national insurance has to do. And I agree with him. That talking about collecting outstanding on arrears, that doesn't do it. But the real deal is, it's the decision that the government has to make. And so when I hear the Prime Minister say, you know, they are contemplating what to do, they know they have to do something, he's trying not to put any more burden. Well, if national insurance collapses, where do you think the burden of that collapse will fall? Let me ask you all, if national insurance is incapable of paying future benefits, do you think that is going to fall more on poor and middle-class people or more on wealthy Bahamians or people? Where do you think it will fall? It will fall on poor and middle-class Bahamians. If national insurance is incapable of paying their benefits, the rich will take their savings and they'll do whatever private insurance they got and pension they got, and they will live. For national insurance to collapse, that burden falls on who? So it would be, and the burden would be more expensive for the poor and the middle class if national insurance fund fails. Because a couple of dollars more a week to be paid now in increments, as opposed to I can't get a benefit for my retirement, I can't get a benefit for my maternity leave, I can't get a benefit for my, that burden is going to be even greater. You know, so why, listen, honestly, Prime Minister, I mean, honestly, I understand the Prime Minister's interest in quote, not putting more burden on people. But again, it seems to me that is a looking at the matter, not quite in the way that one could look at it. It's not a putting of a burden, it's a saving of a burden. When you are in your old age, when you can no longer earn the kind of income you earn, you know how many people look forward, however small that check is from national insurance, to be unable to get that is a burden at a time you can least afford that burden. To have the burden now when you're still working, still strong, and you know, and capable of making your contribution, to have it when you have no income because you can't get any benefit, that is an even greater burden. It's an investment in your own future circumstances is what the additional sum would be. Right? But that this public tension, this public difference, we made a decision, but no, we didn't make a decision. The minister responsible for national insurance, Minister of State responsible for national insurance said a decision was made, you know. Said a decision was made. I know Miles Baroda. I've always believed him to be a cogent, considerate, thoughtful gentleman. Always thought so. Forthright, when he was responsible for the Public Disclosure Commission. This gentleman was chairman of the Public Disclosure Commission and stayed in that position across two governments, two administrations. Why? Because that's how highly they regarded his sobriety. Right? And so he's making that plea. But his colleague is the Prime Minister. He said there was a decision was made by the cabinet, no less. But the Prime Minister, some days later, seems like the matter is still in abeyance. Says, where can we find any of these definitions? Are these global definitions or definitions instituted only in the Bahamas? I don't understand. What definitions of what? Please tell me what definitions you mean. So I submitted my documents for my retired benefits in September 2022 to NIB. Can anyone help to receive the benefits? I think you made this plea before. What to do is send a WhatsApp to 439. We can only make the inquiry. 439-3043 and see. I don't understand why you maybe there's something about your situation that is unclear. Says, Mr. Laing, what I'm hearing about the NIB fund is a load of foolishness. Where's the Auditor General report and investigative report that these funds were not mismanaged? Additionally, we are all assuming that these negative positions will continue in the future as it's now. where's the actuary report to substantiate this increase? Well, it's only because you haven't read the report, because, yeah, the reports have been done, and the reports have been done by actuaries, my friend. Those reports have been done by actuaries. It's not the Auditor General. The Auditor General audits the government's funds, right? I mean, I'm sure I could audit the national insurance fund. But national insurance funds are audited by accountants, okay? The accounting firms, right? And those are published and produced, right? So you the reports that spoke to the solvency of the fund were done by professional actuaries and the like, and they exist. The reports exist. Okay, so that is not a concern for me. I am fully, and the governments have been aware of, have had possession of this report, so nobody's questioning the integrity of the information related to national insurance's funds and that it's been mismanaged and all that kind of stuff. To me, that's just kind of the kind of talk when you're looking to ignore what professional people say about what is going on. I mean, you're mismanaging national insurance funds doesn't negate the reality that if you pay more than you get in, because people are living longer, therefore have to get pensions for a longer period of time, and that was not anticipated in your forecast, and so forth and so forth, you're going to have the kinds of issues they now have. But this is not new. So to bring this up as a matter of mismanagement of funds, maybe that's your thought, but it's not a thought I think is the problem. The basic issue here is that a decision needing to be made has to be made by the government. Two ministers in the government have said, it seems, two different things. One said a decision was made, and one is saying that we are looking to make a decision. Maybe the decision that was made was best look at it in the future. Maybe that's how it can be reconciled. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we continue our discussions. We'll be back after this break.
Take a stand. Everybody. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
What risk to inflation, soaring energy prices, and global tensions pose to the Caribbean? Join international experts, local professionals, and policymakers at the 9th annual RF Economic Outlook. Be part of the conversation on March 14th by reserving your seat today at rfbeo.com. RFEO 2023 is proudly sponsored by RF Bank and Trust, Alive Doctors Hospital, Fidelity Bank, J.S. Johnson, PwC, and The Tribune.
Girl, you see how Cora eye look funny, all black up yesterday?
But she say she bump into a wall when she's running after the churn them.
Yeah, but last Saturday, you see her arm was all black and blue, right?
What you saying? You think something wrong between her and Jack?
I ain't sure, but you know Jack is a jealous man. I hear him and Cora last Friday. I hear him say he hear Cora have eyes for Junior.
Now, you know that ain't true. Cora is a good woman, does mind her business, take care of them churn, and go to church every Sunday. So what you think we should do?
I think we should report Jack, you know. Cora don't say nothing, but silence hides violence, and we don't want to line up in the cemetery.
Not me. I ain't getting in nobody business. Then Jack come after me and I line up next to Cora.
No, man, we could call a text Crime Stopper. And remember, we can even get some grocery money for our tip.
Remind me again how this work.
We can call them in Miami at 328 tips or 328-8477. Or when we in the island, call toll free at 300 tips or 300-8477. And if you don't have no minutes, use the Crack Crime Bahamas app and we could text them. And the messages get on mix up before it leave your phone. So nobody can know what you're saying.
So what are we waiting on then? Let's go earn some grocery money.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather,
Jack gentlemen, to Z Live. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. So changing gears, listen to me, folks. I love the Royal Bahamas Police Force. By that, I mean, I believe in their mission. I know what they have to do on a daily basis to keep the country safe and the like. But, this situation with Lincoln Bean and his group, I am trying to understand it right now. So I don't know a whole lot yet. I don't know if what he was arrested for. I don't know how everything went down. I only saw some video clips and I heard lots of people getting absolutely emotional, passionate, and what have you. So I don't want to, I don't want to elevate something beyond where it is. But I think this is precisely the challenge. At some point you make a calculation, right? You make a calculation about people's activity. And you ask yourself the question, again, I'm not a police. I don't know policing. So I don't know what goes into all the judgments that police make when they decide whether something should be halted, someone should be arrested, and all that kind of stuff, right? I do know that you have to be arrested for an alleged violation of the law. I do know that. Now, what law you could violate out there, where Lincoln and his group were, disturbing the peace, public nuisance, gathering without a permit. I don't know. But I wonder sometimes, if you don't decide, you know what? If I intervene here and it escalates to a place where people have video cameras suggesting some woman is being manhandled, where someone is being arrested for causes that people can't really assess and all that kind of stuff. And now you got this drama playing out and this can get on your national news and your local news and your social media and maybe the international media picks it up because you are now hosting international people from all over the world who ain't gonna know the backstory to nothing, who just can see things play out and who might have their own prejudices and biases about what is happening in the Bahamas and so forth and so forth. And you wonder, okay, do I just let them make noise or have their day or have their say and contain it to the extent that I don't want any harm or threat of harm to come to anyone? I don't know. I mean, because at this point, what I'm seeing is I'm seeing the possibility that people become martyred or look like a martyr or a hero or a legend in a circumstance created more from the actual thing they were doing than from what was done to them, right? So that the story isn't the international people who may have been the target of their protest. The story may not be, we have an illegal immigration problem that's out of control. We have a government that's doing X, Y, Z, too. Look at how you get manhandled by the police in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. That's what can evolve. Because from my mind, again, I wasn't out there, but I'm saying you make that calculation to think, you know what? Let these people, these Bahamian people, in a society that that allows for free assemblage, that allows for a free expression, allow them to say their say in as peaceful and civil a manner as is possible. It's not an out of control. It's not a massive crowd. Nobody is, you know, I don't know. So I call a couple of my police friends, right? You know, and I just act, you know, just trying to see, you know, because I'm not a police, I don't know. Just to see. I'm baffled. I've been to international meetings. Prime Minister Ingram and I went to a meeting in Canada, and the meetings were shut down for a couple of days. We were in a hotel room, couldn't get out the hotel for a couple of days because people were outside protesting. And I mean, terribly protesting. Right? And that was a huge crowd. You know, people are always at these meetings protesting. Oh, the WTO is the devil. The United Nations is an abomination. The World Bank is trying to take over the world for a few wealthy people. You always have those kinds of things. And then you have people with legitimate concerns about what was happening in South Africa, what's happening in some sub-Saharan African countries, what's happening in the United States, what's happening in the United Kingdom. Legitimate concerns about the way things are being done, right? You have this, that things will happen. Here, you know, the story now is, my God, look at what we have come to. Not at all representing the country, you know, the situation. Represent an instance of something, but not at all representing the country. But that's the story. Look at what we have come to. Look at how they're dealing with the Bahamian people, blah, and so forth and so forth. Why? For me, it have been handled differently. I saw the police, mind you, trying to be restrained. I did see in some of the video, I saw that. I saw the police trying to tell people to stay back, do this, do the next thing. But boy, let me tell you something. If I had barricades out there, as long as you behind the barricade, you could shout and say whatever you want. Just stay behind the barricade. That's called containment for me. So this text says they were too heavy-handed. I am not quite prepared to say that yet, but I am saying that, you know, I don't know. This text says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. Is there a possibility that you would be able to, in the first quarter, host Pandora Butler from executive at NIB, now retired, to educate us on NIB Act benefits, etc., as she really dives deep into and knows her stuff? Thank you. I would absolutely love it. No problem. How would you call her and tell her I would love to have her come on and share? I'd love to do it. No problems. Okay. I don't have a contact for her, but if you can reach out to her and she can reach out to me as you did, I'm happy to do so. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We are going to take a break. We'll be back after this break.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Fair down.
With so much going on in the world today, only accepting cash at your business can be risky. Let Fidelity offer you and your customers safety, convenience, and the flexibility of a fixed or mobile terminal. Take it with you, on the move and on the go, because business should never stop. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit us at any of our branches.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live, I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad that you could join me here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. I trust and hope that you are doing well. If you want to give us a call, you can call us on 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. Let me tell you all something. A person or persons can be seem marginal today, but they can be made mainstream tomorrow. You know why? Not so much because what they are saying or doing makes the most sense, but sometimes when they are handled in a way, people's sympathy start to turn an ear to their cause. The Bahamas is in this situation. This is among the things that's happening in the Bahamas, to my mind. Large segments of the Bahamian population are under enormous economic and financial stress, large portions. The unemployed portions, the underemployed portions, and the working class Bahamians who have seen no appreciable increase or improvement in their income situation in ages are under enormous stress. It's not, listen to me, people, listen to me, please. I'm sorry, I just like to say that. It's just the way I talk. Don't. What is happening is not just a matter of their financial stress. It's a stress of hopefulness. See, you and I know this to be true. I could have no money today, but if I see a path to money coming tomorrow, I live today with a hopefulness that makes me feel less stressed. But when you're current situation is stressed, and when you cannot look into the future with a belief that you will have improvements in your situation, add to that your children are also faced with this lack of improvement in their circumstances, You now start thinking about the suffocating realities of your circumstances, and your cheese now looks that much smaller. And you cannot afford, or you believe you cannot afford, for anyone to move your cheese, anyone to be nibbling at your cheese, anyone to be taking slices of your pie. And life now becomes a choice between, when you are in survival mode, life becomes one of us against them. Who is the them? Them is the people who are not supposed to be nibbling on my pie. So it is clear why immigration is such a significant issue in the Bahamas. People are under enormous stress and strain. And Lincoln, Bain and his crew and others who are pushing this issue are not out of their minds to be looking at this as a significant issue. It is a pulse that is beating for the Bayman people, not just poor people, not just middle-class people, even up the socioeconomic ladder, it's a pulse. Now, these same people may not like the approach taken by Lincoln or others and so forth, but that doesn't, the issue is their issue too, though. Now you add to that, that they're making the effort they're making and being in perceived as, or in reality, treated in a way that appears to be an affront to their liberties, you're going to make them an issue. And what may be marginal today may become mainstream tomorrow. That doesn't mean, oh, they can become the government or not the government. That's a choice for the Bahamian people. But what it does mean is that people start making calculations about how best to appropriate their efforts. And may, by virtue of sympathy, give them a bit more play than maybe even they would deserve, right? So the Bahamas is a fairly civil place, man. Come on, you all know this, man. We go through our noise making and debates and our confrontations and so forth, but by and large, we are a civil place. So I do not believe, I listen to some of the rhetoric of people who are at some of the gatherings and then Paul Rawson Square, etc., and that rhetoric is just off the chain nonsense, crap, stupidness. We don't want to hear that. We don't need that in the Bahamas. We don't. Listen to me. You don't need to tell a prime minister. You don't need to cuss him. You don't need to debase him. You don't need to lie on him. You don't need to threaten him. We don't need that for you to make a point. You could say to a prime minister, listen, let me explain something to you. Your government's actions, policies, or inactions are a failure. You could say that if that's what you believe. You could say that. You could say a strong language. In fact, you might get better carriage if you say that language, because if you cuss, the president can carry you, right? So you could say, listen, man, on this score, you all are doing this and that. The Bahamian people are under, blah, blah. You can say all those things and never be threatening or and nasty. We don't need that. That's not us. I was saying to somebody, it was curious to me to listen to people who say Haitians are not like us. This is what they say. Haitians are not like us because they're violent and this and the next thing. And the same people who are protesting against the illegal Haitians are threatening violence. Really? So you're contradicting your message. You're muddying your message. You can turn people off. You don't have to do that. You can, if you out there, first of all, being out there, you're making a stand. And people see. You say stuff, people hear you, man, and you can say potent things. You can say very intelligently potent things that can get carriage. We're a civil country. We don't need the people of the Bahamas to become uncivil, and we don't need the police to be uncivil. We don't. Most police officers I'm aware of, I know, especially in the senior command, are professional people. They approach life professionally. They want to be regarded as professionals. They understand the nuance of force and power and why it's a difficulty. The commissioner don't want a need to have a scenario in which his force is regarded as overreaching, overpowering in any circumstance. Because when you then have to use power and really be forceful, you don't get the benefit of the doubt. And the police needs to have the benefit of the doubt, because society has to cooperate with the police for civility to prevail. Be sure of that, because there are always more people in the society than police. Always. If you get more police than people, something wrong with your society. You are a failing state. If people have to use a massive force to contain people, you are not in a democratic society. You are not in a civil society. So I hope the law takes its course, because the police can't and don't have to, shouldn't ignore breaches of the law. But we also know that the judgments can be made about conduct, and sometimes in the larger scheme of things, judgments are made that says, you know what, it's probably better to do this than to do this, because in the medium to long term, we will be better off. So we'll see how it plays out. If you write me and call me trying to suggest that the Bahamas has come to nothing, to naught, to waste, to this and the next thing, you're not going to get me to buy into that discussion with you. If you call and say, I don't like the way things were handled today, I thought that there was this and that and the next thing, I can listen to you, I can hear you, but don't generalize to me, because I live in the same country. I've lived there for 55 years of my life. I've seen the police in all their forms. I've seen the police over time, and you're not gonna convince me, but the Bahamas is no come to nothing this. You ain't gonna convince me. You can say it and shout it and cry it. You'll not convince me of that. If you want to say, look at what has happened today and look at how badly it is handled today, you got my ear. You got my ear. I should listen and read and go from there. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break for news. And then when we come back, we will continue our discussions. We'll be back after this news break.
Come take my hand, walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody, come take my hand, We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live, I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers to do so are 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316 or 325-4259, 325-4259. You can text us on 4224796, that's 4224796, so you can WhatsApp me on 4393043, that's 4393043. So CARICOM is meeting, and, well, I, I got some messages about the extensive traffic jams that came about in Nassau arising, it seems, from some of the road closures in relation to CARICOM, and people were irritated about it and so forth. I can understand that. But I've seen that play itself out in other places in the world where these international meetings have been held too. In fact, not forget international meetings. I've seen traffic jams created because the president of the United States of America was making his way to George Washington University, where I was in Washington at the time, attending school, doing my MBA, and it was horrendous. I was navigating to get to class was like crazy because everything was shut down, closed down, police everywhere, and so forth. So it's not pleasant. People are complaining about how long it's taking them to get to work and to be able to do what they have to do, and that the police wasn't perhaps as organized as they needed to be, or at least it wasn't clear enough what roads would be closed so people could make a proper decision making. There are all kinds of things. So CARICOM has had that impact on some members of the public. But this meeting is happening, high-profile meeting. I believe in international meetings. I believe in regional meetings. The reason for that is it's better for world leaders to be in discussions with each other than for them to be guessing what each other is doing. And it is also possible that these meetings can translate into cooperation that helps get needed assistance, needed support, needed consensus for various kinds of actions. So they make a difference. They can be full of pomp and pageantry sometimes and a bunch of talk, but they have over the years made a difference. I think the record is clear on that, right? That's why people go and make appeals to them, because they think that they can make a difference. Chogum's meeting in Nassau, where a huge stance was made for the release of Nelson Mandela, made a difference. And that's why when he came out of prison, one of the first places Nelson Mandela visited officially was the Bahamas, because he wanted to say thank you, because he knew what happened. So these meetings can make a difference. They can make a difference. And so that our government is engaged in international meetings, is engaged in international dialogue, it makes good sense. It's pressing for climate change to be, acknowledged and maybe something done in the way of financing. Fine, I don't have any difficulty with that. That makes good sense. And disagree with him as you wish. Minister Fred Mitchell, as a Minister of Foreign Affairs, tends to have a keen sense of these international discussions. You may not agree with the stances the Bahamas takes on this, that, or the next thing. That's fine. But there is seldom a knee-jerk reaction to what is happening. I would give him his props for that. But I do want to say this, and because this international meeting sets a backdrop for this truism, international politics and domestic politics have a different feel, flavor, and focus. In many instances, feel, flavor, and focus. See, in that international arena, I want you to think through what the players experience, the leaders, this is the leaders, as they are going through these international meetings. They go to these places where people try to make sure that their countries are on their best footing. They go and they see all these flags raised, they see all these very clean police officers, defense officers, national security people, secret service people all over the place attending to their safety, so they feel secure. They go and they stay in facilities, hotels that are nicely polished because the people know we are entertaining world leaders. They go to facilities that are nicely air conditioned and have all the amenities they need and all the service they need to attend to their needs. That is not the real world. Well, it's the real world, but it's not the world on the ground being experienced by most people in these countries. And no matter, even if it's the United States of America, it's not the life most people are experiencing. So there is a certain, and then they go and they're able to make these lofty speeches where people will sit down very often, not always, but sit down very often quietly and listen and, you know, with great diplomatic posturing and so forth and so forth. That is not the world most people live in. On the ground, people live in a hustle-bustle world. Their surroundings, though nice, is not the best and tops in the world for many, many, many. Life is hard and challenging, and to get things done is very difficult. When you are in the international community and you say, I need this, I need that, and that. Realities on the ground. And the realities on the ground in the Bahamas set against the backdrop of CARICOM is that Bahamian people in the main are frustrated with their economic circumstances and related, connected, the illegal immigration circumstances in the country. Frustrated. The mood of the people of this country will change and improve where they feel and see and believe there is economic prosperity expanding for them. At the moment, that seems stagnated. And it has been that way for some years now. It's been that way across several administrations, including the one to which I belonged in from 2007 to 2012. The economy, you know, we had the Great Recession. The economy just wasn't churning out prosperity. It wasn't, not in. Not between 2007, 2012 under Ingram, even though there were some marginal gains. Not between 2012, 2017 under Mr. Christie. And certainly not between 2017, 2021 under Dr. Minnis, because they had a potpourri of issues that also came and sat on the economy. And so people are flustered, frustrated. Mind you, we still live in a really, really good country to the extent that we don't live in this under the threat of constant threat of war or under war conditions. We're not featured to the kind of instability and incivility that you can find in so many societies. We are still a fairly good-natured people and tend toward peaceful dealings with each other rather than not. We are not crime infested, though murder continues to hang over our heads like a dark cloud. You know, we can have a reasonably okay time at it. But that notwithstanding, because we have become accustomed to a certain material existence, because we have become used to being able to see upticks in our economic fortunes, we find a situation in which unemployment remains persistently high, in which wages remain persistently stagnant, in which future prospects for economic expansion and improvement are limited. People are frustrated. And they can find a place to put that frustration. They put it on the others, the illegal immigrants. They can put it on the politicians, whoever in office. They can put it on the priests and the pastors because they need some help. And it becomes an uneasy thing. right? And so, you know, enjoy as we might the wonders of international dialogue, meetings, conferencing, and travel. But stay absorbed in the felt and lived experiences of the people of the country, because those experiences do not match the experiences of that environment. They do not. And you can tell, whenever you see people start to get really outlandish about their protests and trepidations about things, because some of the utterances that people utter are really, they're not reasonable, quite honestly. They're not. I don't say all, I said some. You know, like the country's going to hell. The country's not going to hell, but, you know, I could think of countries that might be described as becoming hellish. Mahomes isn't one of them, but, you know, when people, all these governments incompetent and all that kind of stuff, that's not reasonable talk, but it's but you can't not listen, because it is a reflection of frustration. What is frustration? What is frustration? Frustration is, I need this ball to move. I need this rock to move. I need this door to open. I need this door to close. I need something to happen. I need this to elevate. I need this to lower. But I cannot get it to do so. I cannot get it to do so. No matter what I have tried, I cannot. And so the difference between what I want and what I am able to get, that gap is where my frustration gets defined. You are never frustrated when you are making progress. You're never frustrated when the things that you want to happen are happening. You get frustrated when your children, you want your children to go to school and they can't. When you want to buy some grocery and you can't. When you want to see the doctor, but you can't afford it. You get frustrated when you want your life to be better, but it can't get better. It doesn't seem. You want something in your country to end, but it won't end. You want something in your country to start, but it won't start. Then frustration kicks in. Frustration leads to anger, because frustration is hurtful, it's painful, and painful people get angry. Every time you see somebody angry, you look for the hurt. All anger is rooted in hurt. Grief, sadness, rooted in loss. Anger, in hurt. And so people are frustrated about their economic circumstances, their frustration, but something that, you know, and you see, when you have, like, if you have a good job, you're getting good money, and you can pay your bills reasonably, and so forth and so forth, it's hard to feel what people feel who are not in that situation, and that's true, right? Because that's just not your circumstance. You have to literally empathize, and empathy means to suffer with. That's what empathy means, that I have to imagine myself suffering what you are suffering. And in that imagination, I may feel some semblance of it. And when people are hurt and frustrated and angry, they don't always act rationally. In fact, in many times we don't act rationally. We say things we shouldn't say. We do things we shouldn't do. Because we're frustrated, we're angry, we're hurt. We want the pain to end. We want the suffering to end. We want the discomfort, dis-ease to end. And I'm only saying, this is not the Davis administration, I'm saying any government. But the government, the minister, the politicians, we say We are the answer. They were not the answer. We are the answer. People believe you. And maybe they shouldn't, because maybe if they looked at the problem in a realistic way, they'd say, yeah, chances of you fixing that, especially within the next so years, is slim to none, but you know, but they believe you. You took it on. You say you could do it. And so now, disappointed by that one, that group, then disappointed by this group, then disappointed by the next group, what happens is the hope deferred is now making the heart sick. People get flustered. What do you do? What do we do? How do we get past this? How do we get beyond this moment, this time, this season, this frustration, these hard issues, these difficult problems, these pressing challenges, seemingly beyond our control? How do we deal with that? How do we deal with that? We thought it would be done by this person, that person, this group, that group. No, not yet. How do we deal with that? What next? when we come back from the break, I would just utter some thoughts about it. Just utter some thoughts about it. Right? Maybe you and I could see if we agree. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
So much going on in the world today, only accepting cash at your business can be risky. Let Fidelity offer you and your customers safety, convenience, and the flexibility of a fixed or mobile terminal. Take it with you, on the move and on the go, because business should never stop. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit us at any of our branches.
Marsh the car? The lady run into me, marsh the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
The Water and Sewage Corporation advises customers in New Providence and Village Road and surrounding areas that due to ongoing pipeline tie-ins into the water main, their water supply will be interrupted from Saturday, February 11th, 2023, to Thursday, February 16, 2023, between the hours of 10 p.m. to 3 a.m. the following morning. The corporation apologizes for any inconvenience caused as they work to improve their level of service.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody,
back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today. on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to call, you can call on 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp on 439-3043. Confronted as we are with all these difficult problems, we have an illegal immigration problem that will not relent. We have an economic situation that is not improving to the extent of making us feel a lot better off. We have persistent problems with the way we function. Maybe it's the traffic, maybe it's the crime or that. And, like we feel like it ain't moving, like it ain't moving the way it ought, the way we want. And so what do you do? Right? What do you do? Because when things are negative, are happening around you or to you, and you feel like you can't change them, frustration grows. You feel like you have no control and you become despondent. And the question is, you know, in the face of that, what do you do? So I'm only offering you some thoughts on the matter, right? Some thoughts related to the way I approach it and the way I've been taught by other people to approach it. When reality around you or happening to you cannot be changed by you, if you can't bend the reality, bend yourself. Right? Because if you can't move it, if you can't push it, if you can't pull it, if you can't make it happen, if your mind continues to beat itself up by agonizing, complaining, criticizing, etc., you're now adding another problem to your problem, which is your own mental situation, your own mental wellness. So the situation ain't changing, so I have to change in the situation. And you know what my change in the situation is? It's not to give up. I'm not giving up. What I am understanding is at the moment, I cannot by myself make this different. So I have to change me. And my change is a enduring of the current state of affairs with an attitude of gratitude, grace, and hope, so that I am in the best mental situation to do the next thing I can do once I have changed my mind to endure. The other words I'm using, endure, means tolerate for some period of time that which is uncomfortable to me. That is called patience. Most times when you see us really agitated and aggravated with stuff that ain't happening because we're frustrated, it's because we will not let patience have her perfect work in us. What is patience? Enduring suffering like a good soldier. Listen to me. I've watched a lot of war movies lately, a lot of them, from antiquities to current. And soldiers, man, what they have to put up with is into me, folk. I've never been a soldier in war, but I promise you, I trust no me nor no child of mine ever does it. But if it ever had to happen, I pray I can have the courage and testicular fortitude that some of the soldiers I saw have. You know, back in the day, if you're looking at the war between the Mongols and the Chinese, if you're looking at the war between the British and the Vikings, if you're looking at the war between the Allied forces and the Germans, them, like every time they went into battle, every time that, yeah, somebody quoted saying Private Ryan, yeah, that's as vivid as you can get, right? Listen, did not somebody got to have to storm the, go first on the beach at Normandy, had to go on the beach first, they get shot the heck up. I'm going to, and I'm saying though, while that was happening, others came after. They knew and saw what happened to their colleagues. They were in places where you couldn't eat or couldn't eat where you couldn't, you weren't unsafe, et cetera, but they had to endure it like good soldiers. That's what patience is. Patience is enduring hardship like a good soldier. Listen to me, Bahamians. Bahamian, mommy, daddy, brother, sister, auntie, uncle, grandma, grandpa, little brother, little sister. Listen to Zhivargo. If you can't move the situation, you gotta move your mind to endure it like a good soldier. Yeah. Now, while you are enduring it like a good soldier, just think, what can I do? See, because maybe the thing you can do won't move the needle right away, or maybe won't move the needle at all, but do what you can do. Because sometimes you have to get comfort in the process of knowing, I am not just sitting here letting my situation deteriorate, let my situation consume me. I will do what I can do. So I have a financial problem. Things are tight and I really can't make ends meet. Okay, so I promise you, saving $2 on your grocery bill mightn't fix the entirety of your situation, but it certainly ain't gonna make it worse. It certainly will save $2. So you do what you can do. You do what you can do. You see, I do not subscribe to every method being employed by some of the folks I see who are protesting about the illegal immigration problem, right? But they are doing what they think they can do. And for them, that's power. For them, that's hope. You know, and so you do what you can do. With civility, with grace, with, you know, reasoning, with wisdom, but you do what you can do, right? You do what you can do. And then when you've done what you could do, having a mindset that says, you know, I can't bend this word, but I could bend my mind. You leave the rest after the providence of God. Hopefully other people will do their stuff too, but you can't control what other people do, so you can't put your faith and confidence there. You leave the rest up, and then you just watch it. Like, and then, you know, I was at a church meeting in Orlando, and I went to Orlando, and a friend of mine who pastors a church there, he asked me if I could speak to his church one evening, and so I agreed to do so. And while I was speaking to folks about some of the same stuff, I asked them, I said, I mean, how many of you have been in situations that you thought you couldn't get out of? Practically everybody raised their hands. And then I asked, how many of you got out of the situation you thought you couldn't get out of? And practically everybody raised their hands. And then I asked, how many of you have multiple times been in situations you thought you couldn't get out of? And most people raised their hands. And I said, how many of you got out of every situation multiple times you thought you couldn't get out of? And everybody raised their hands. And then I said, how many of you have had things happen to you over the course of your lifetime you thought you couldn't get out of and you couldn't get out of? Most people raised their hands. And I said, how many of you got out of those things? And most people raised their hands. I said, you know what that is? That's experience that tells you most things that happen to you will pass. Why, therefore, should you not have hope? You 80 years old in the Bahamas. You 70 years old in the Bahamas. You 90 years old in the Bahamas. You 60 years old in the Bahamas. You 50 years old. You've been through some things, man. If you wrote a book about all the stuff that you overcome, everybody would think you were a hero or very lucky or blessed. Right? In the moment that we're going through stuff, it don't feel good. It almost always feels hopeless sometimes. Well, not even it make no sense. It almost always feels hopeless. It often feels hopeless. Or sometimes it feels hopeless. Right? But think about how many things we've gotten out of. Listen, I'm talking about even as a younger person, right? You may not have the big challenges of your parents. Like my mother, I watched my mother struggle with some big challenges, right? Big things to have to contend with raising 9 children as she did. Right? Big challenges. But as a child, I don't have to find food for 9 children. I don't have to find whole housing for 9 children. I don't have to pay for that. But I had circumstances where, you know, when you and a friend have a fallout and it feels so bad, like you feel like this will never fix. Never fix. Right? It's as simple as that for a child. But guess what? You and a friend still friends today. But it didn't feel like that then, though. Right? You have you make a decision and you know it was bad. You know it was awful, right? And you think, this is going to take me under, right? This is going to do me in. And it doesn't. Even if you suffer from it, even if you have wounds from it, right? Still, if you look on my feet, you'll see that I have extensive, well, you can't see them as much now, but I had extensive burns on my 2 feet, right? How? When I was, I don't know, I think around 3, 4, 5, something like that, I was watching a woman boil, like, you know how they used to boil the chicken to pluck them so it would pluck easier? Well, I was standing around the fire with the pot, and the pot turned over. And all that hot, scalding, boiling water went on my 2 feet. I had third-degree burns. You could tell from the scars that they were third-degree burns. Right? Now, I mean, for a mother to have to deal with that and for a child to have to go through that, you think, wow, that's like, really? But that's been like over 50 years ago. I don't feel that. I don't know nothing about that. I just have the scars. Right? This stuff comes to pass, man. And even if the thing takes us out, it don't have to take us down. Because even in being out, we can go up to better. Right? So I'm saying is, you know, you can get frustrated with these politicians all you want. You can get frustrated with your pastor and preacher all you want. You can get frustrated with your boss and them all you want. How is that moving the needle for you? How's that making it better for you? No, you bend your mind, you do what you can, and you leave the rest up to the great God Almighty. Right? That's why I feel the discomfort of this ease of this nation. I do. I mean, I feel I could feel that toughness, tenseness, that, you know, looking and needing and wanting better. But it ain't gonna crush my spirit. Because there's an approach you have to take in the circumstance. And you can only do what you could do. Let's take our final break, ladies and gentlemen, and then when we come back, we will finalize our discussions. We'll be back after this break.
Take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm.
inflation, soaring energy prices, and global tensions host to the Caribbean. Join international experts, local professionals, and policymakers at the 9th annual RF Economic Outlook. Be part of the conversation on March 14th by reserving your seat today at rfbeo.com. RFEO 2023 is proudly sponsored by RF Bank and Trust, Alive Doctors Hospital, Fidelity Bank, J.S. Johnson, PwC, and The Tribune.
It's a new year, and you're super excited to start the year off right. You've made your New Year's resolutions, doing more exercising, healthier eating, saving more, making better decisions and all that. If you have information or products that encourages healthy living, promotes sound financial decisions, or even promotes a positive lifestyle, one smart decision is to advertise in the Nassau Guardian's Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise supplement. So if you're a physician, speech, massage, or physiotherapist, own a gym, nutritional deli, or restaurant, does your financial insurance institution or credit institution have the plan for investing wisely? Then that information should be in the Nassau Guardian's Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise supplement. One low price gives you an ad in the supplement plus 15 30-second commercials. Interviews also available on Star 106 Hits, Guardian Radio, and Hot 91. Contact your account executives or the Nassau Guardian now. Start the new year right in the Nassau Guardian's Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise supplement.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, you can call us on 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. Y'all must have had a great Valentine's Day. Y'all still in the euphoria of the love you got on Valentine's Day. I will tell y'all a story, right? I bought this soursop tree. I bought it from a nursery. And when I was buying it, I noticed the leaves were a little scorched. And so I asked the lady, I said, why, how come the leaves are so scorched? She said, we just had the little storm and so that will happen, which made sense because I've seen how storms scorch the leaves of trees. So I said, no problem. So I took the soursop tree home. I planted it in my garden. And over the weeks, I watched this plant looked like it was dying. I mean, the leaves were getting worse and worse and dropping off. And I was thinking to myself, this plant is going to die. I said, I'm going to go back to the nursery and tell the lady, I bought this plant. This plant died on me. I mean, I'm talking about, I watched them leaves, till it was two leaves on there. And the branches looking dead brown. I'm like, this was disheartening for me. Right. And I said, yeah, this is, I decided one Saturday morning I was going to pull it up because this didn't make no sense that the plant really was dead. And I said, no, just wait for what? I don't know. I didn't know why it should wait, but I said, wait. So, I traveled a little bit over time and so never really. And then while I was weeding the garden, I noticed something. I noticed these little small, tiny, almost microscopic green something. So I went and looked closely at it, right? And I noticed there were little leaves coming out. And I was like, wow, could it be? Could it be that it's catching the sun? Well, today, those are full leaves. Full leaves. I almost threw that soursop tree away. Why? Because all the appearance of it, and all that I saw over time, suggested to me this plant was dead. This was dead. This was dead. This, and so I was thinking that, but I wasted money, it's a waste of time, boom, boom, boom. But a split decision to wait. And a set of circumstances that made me have to wait because I wasn't there. And hope sprang eternal. And I said, you know, some Zhivargo, that's a life lesson. How many times we look at a situation and we think, geez, this dead. This is not gonna work out. This is hopeless. I need to just pull this up and get rid of this. You see, the problem is we look at the surface, right? We can only see what we see. We don't see the work being done deep down in the ground. We don't know the dynamics at work in the background. Even if you take it far enough, we don't know what's happening in the mind. We don't know what's happening in the heart. Yay, we don't even know what's happening in the spirit. We don't know. So maybe it needs more time until you can really be sure it's dead. So don't kill it. If it's dying anyhow, just make sure it's dead. I was listening to the late Dr. Miles Monroe, and he was giving a talk. He says, never apply a permanent solution to a temporary problem. In other words, make sure the situation really dead, really hopeless, really lifeless, before you take a measure that will almost guarantee that it would be. And so you sit where you sit, dealing with what you're dealing with, us in the country, sitting where we sit, dealing with what we're dealing with. Yeah, it could look away. But hey, you know, we don't know what's going on in the background. All we could do is do what we do. You know what I had to do? So what I did was I got some fertilizer and some new soil, and I surrounded that soursop tree with that fertilizer and the new soil. I said to myself, you know, maybe this needs a little bit more tender, loving care, and so you need to water it every day. Because it may need an extra boost, so keep watering it every day. You know, I don't typically water my garden every day, but maybe this is what is required for this plant. So that's what I did. And lo and behold, right? So you do what you could do to nurture, to encourage, to better, to improve, to promote the situation. Because sometimes the signs of life just ain't there where we can see it. But in underneath the ground, where the roots are deeply planted, life is finding a way. Right? And I shared that with you because my sense is that some people are up against it. Now, the mistake we make is thinking like the only people who are up against it are people who are unemployed or severely poor. That's not true. Some people today are working in circumstances where they are saying, listen, I cannot give a strong effort because I am discouraged by what I have to deal with in this place. Some people feel like, you know, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. I can't do it anymore. I've been doing this for a long time, and you know, like it don't seem like nothing changing, and I just abide my time. And they're okay financially, they're okay otherwise, but their morale is sunk. You know? Some people say, you know, they're looking for encouragement. Like sometimes you're in a situation where you're looking for young people to follow behind you, and you're hoping that these young people kind of have the kind of energy and enthusiasm and commitment and intellectual capacity to step up to the plate, and you don't see it, and you get discouraged by that. That's what got you discouraged. Sometimes you pastoring people and you thinking, you hoping that they will improve their attitude and their sense of commitment to the faith, and you guys don't see it? Well, all the results on planet Earth depend on you and me. Never did. Parents, you do your best for children. All the results don't depend on you, on your effort alone. Zaza, I don't buy people who tell me, this gone wrong, blame the parents. It's nonsense. Nonsense, because sometimes things happen that have nothing to do with your parenting. But with the choices children make or the choices people make around them. You teach your child, be civil. You teach your child, be peaceful. You teach your child, be gracious. They go out to a certain place. Two people who have a different point of view in life are fighting. Your child get stabbed. Not in the fight, you know, but was incidental to the fight. Injured, dies. That's on the parent? That's not on the parent. Right? But you could be up against it. All I'm saying is, remember that apparently dying sours off tree. Just remember that. And you know the truth is, if you garden, you've been there, you've been where I am talking about many times, where them flowers, them veggies, like, especially if you just plant them anew from someplace, they go limp on you. They start going dry on you, and you're thinking, oh my God, the whole thing dead. I'm going to lose this crop. And it feels bad because this is your effort, your energy, your money. And it feels bad. But when you see them, they start picking up because, why, you nurtured them. You watered them. You gave them the care and the attention you thought you could give. And they come back to life. Oh, my goodness. Now you're springing with joy. And that can happen in other parts of our situation. I believe that we need a moment of honesty in the Bahamas. And when I say honesty, I mean we need to be honest with ourselves. We need to concede that we neither have or have had the wherewithal to fix some of the problems we have. Some people might say, there are people out there who could fix it. Okay, but they ain't in the position where they could be the ones who fix it. So we only could have what we have. And if we can have that moment of humility, maybe we can start looking deeper in ourselves for other kinds of things that might be brought to bear on our problems. Or we can ask people who have fixed that problem, maybe they can help us fix this problem, because we've been honest enough to admit it to ourselves. Big problem in the Bahamas is economic growth. A huge problem. And I don't mean just the economy growing. I mean the economy growing, creating jobs, and creating more income and prosperity for people across the board. We have that as a persistent problem. We have not found a way to fix that problem. We have not found. There is not now a strategy to fix that problem. Not today. And, well, let me backtrack. If you know of a strategy that is now currently being deployed to fix that problem, then maybe you can let us know. Because maybe that can give some hope to us. But we have had this as a persistent problem for some time now. And it's not been resolved. Let's put it like that. And maybe we can see it. You know what? We don't have a solution to this problem. Maybe then we'll start really searching for one. Right? Now, I have some I have some studies that point in a direction, but that's in the direction. The details and the workings out and all that kind of stuff may need to happen. But if we continue doing now what we are doing now, 10 years from now, on the basis of the results we're getting today, where will we be 10 years from now? If we continue doing what we're doing now, getting the results we are getting now, where will we be 10 years from now? For instance, if we do now for the next 10 years what we've been doing at NIB, where will NIB be 10 years from now? Ask yourself that question. if we're doing our crime fighting 10 years from now, what we're doing now, where will our crime situation be? If we do for the next 10 years what we're doing now in our illegal immigration situation, where will that be 10 years from now? That's all you have to ask yourself. If you want to know if in your personal life or in the life of the country, if you are on the right track, just ask yourself, what you're doing now, you do for the next 10 years, where will you be? Let me tell you something what is true. They say, there's a quote that says, don't celebrate your harvest, celebrate the seeds that you're sowing, because that's your next harvest. You've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I hope you have a great, great evening. God bless you. We'll talk to you again tomorrow. He spares life. Good evening.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Take a stand.